Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. You know, there's no greater hero than Ted Turner. He really invented cable news. But was he a madman or a genius? And here to discuss that question with us tonight is Sir Harry Evans. Thank you very much for coming by, Sir Harry. He has written a book, and this book is called They Made America. And in this book, you will read about the great innovators, Thomas Edison and others, and including Ted Turner. Now, Harry, one of the things I noticed in this book is if you go to this page right here, the audience can't see it, but it's a picture of a, well, let's show it up to the audience. What is that, Harry?
That's a digitalized photograph of Claude Shannon, the man who actually invented the digital age. And this photograph is made up of thousands of small television images. It was put together by a man called Robert Silvers for me, because I wanted to dramatize just what Claude Shannon was a genius. He used to ride on a tiny one-wheel bicycle while juggling balls, mm-hmm. and he was a mathematical genius, and he was the guy who really invented the digital age, or whose paper was absolutely fundamental while he was working on telephone communication for Bell Labs.
And what do you call this part of the book?
That's called the digital age.
The digital age, and he invented the digital age? I thought I invented the digital age.
You just took a ride on the back of Claude Shannon.
You stole the whole show.
Yeah, well, that's only part of the book. I begin with the age of steam. You can be in the age of steam if you like.
Because I'm full of hot air, I suppose. Yeah, sure. Well, okay, let's talk about Ted Turner, a very interesting personality. You'll have to say at least he was nuts, as we use the word, just generally speaking, wouldn't you?
Well,
I mean, not off his mind, but doing very sort of unusual things.
Almost everybody in They Made America is being described as crazy. Raymond Damadian, who created the first picture of the inside of the human body, MRI machine,
yeah.
he was known as Crazy Damadian. Actually, he's a very interesting man, Damadian, because I wrote the chapter, which is technical a little bit, about magnetic resonance imaging and how the body sends radio signals. But I also described him as paranoid, aggressive, egocentric, and overbearing. So I sent him the chapter to read the technicalities, and he marked a couple of technicalities but left the adjectives about himself in. That's a good scientific mind.
Well, in the case of Ted Turner, there are all these stories about acting very unusually.
Well, that's true, but he was called crazy because he had the idea of 24-hour television news. And the network, CBS, ABC, NBC, all said this man's a lunatic. I came to New York in 1982 to see Ted Turner. Actually, I went to Atlanta to see him, but I stopped in New York and I went to all the three network's chiefs. I was working with Goldcrest Film and Television in London, and my job was to start a 24-hour television news service in Europe. Every one of the network chiefs said, tear up that plane ticket to Atlanta. You're wasting your time. He's totally off his head. He's crazy. Now, they weren't talking about Ted throwing a fit, which he does, and which we can talk about. That's what I call an episode of a manic depressive. But the actual idea that he was crazy to invent 24-hour television news, the people who said it weren't crazy, they were just mediocrities.
Well, there are these stories of Ted climbing up the top of a TV antenna and leaving his companion who climbed up with him for 8 hours, a man who worked for him, and just waiting until he got enough nerve to come down. Are there other stories like that?
Well, but probably the most famous is Peter Range of Playboy, who was interviewing him on a plane and thought he was getting on well with him. And he asked him a question about the correlation between television morality and personal morality. And it's well known that Ted's concept of personal morality is very elastic, in the sense that he will fall in love with every woman he meets, and every woman he meets falls in love with him. So it makes for a lot of lovemaking. This question enraged Ted Turner so much, according to Peter Range, that he seized the tape recorder, smashed it to bits on the floor, took the cassettes out, went to the lavatory and flushed them down the toilet. Now, then he came back and he was okay. Well, there are instances like that, but you know, that's an example of high temper. It's not an example of being crazy.
How about when he went to the Senate, one of the Senate committees, and he was testifying about television, and he testified, then lay down on the floor and said, I'm dead.
Well, it was a way of dramatizing the threat that that particular bill opposed for TV. So he has a theatrical streak in him, you may say. And I love it. Actually, when he appeared with me in a They Made America panel, the audience simply adored him because he was with Ken Arletta on another occasion, and Ken asked him question after question after question, and he finally paused, and everybody paused, and he says, "Why haven't you asked me about my marriages?" And so he invites sensation. And with me, it was discussing failure, and he said, "Well, you haven't asked me about my failed marriages." So he knows that he creates a tremendous wake. And if I could use that metaphor, Jim, is it crazy or is it courage when Ted Turner's in the Fastnet Atlantic race that was a disaster that killed scores of people, tremendous seas and raging storms, and he's in the middle of this race and boats are capsizing, and he goes to the helm and he stays there through the night, sailing through the storm, still with a sail up of some kind, totally heading for the rocks of the Scilly Islands, and he's reciting Shakespeare. Oh, cry God for Harry England and St. George. I mean, and he's a marvelous reciter. Was that mad or was it courageous? Well, he came through and he wins the race. Yeah. So, in that vernacular, he's courageous.
Well, we've got another clip of him in his racing, part of his racing history, which I'd like to show right now. And I'll
Can I look at it?
Yeah, we'll both look at it right there. Okay. And we remember that Ted Turner not only had this famous race you're talking about, but had many races to for the America's Cup and won it.
He did. Well,
yeah, he was a famous serious sailor.
But he couldn't have been foolhardy to survive in those conditions.
Right. Well, let's take a look at another part of Ted Turner and his sailing history.
All over, baby.
Every single time he went out on a limb, he came down and made a perfect dive.
Well, now that's Ted Turner in the middle of his race, and one time when he was racing, he brought a reporter on his boat. He asked everyone on the boat to take all their clothes off, and they stood around and killed a mackerel, saying, "Kill the mackerel, kill the mackerel." And how do you fold this into his personality?
Well, it's all part of his high spirits. I mean, I don't think those are not. I have other instances, and they may not be as significant as periods of depression, talk about suicide and things like that. That may be more, you know, what you're describing, basically, and what I just described, I described a moment of anger. Then there are periods of depression. But there are also periods of fantastic high achievement. This man's achievements are monumental. You know, what is he doing? As a young man, he's selling space on billboards. He's climbing up the ladders to stick the billboards around the South. Then he buys a broken down TV station. Then he has the brilliant concept of taking use of a satellite, which has just gone up, and nobody else had thought of doing it apart from HBO for movies, to use that for be a global Turner broadcasting system. That's brilliant. And then he has another fit when the satellite, which he's bought space on, the second one, blows up. And they put him to the back of the queue, and he goes to RCA, and then he has to do some of this "I'm dead" stuff, and he has to throw a fit.
But
he gets his way, and it's an effective bargaining tool. And I think behind some of Ted's explosions, there's a calculating rationality. Well, just think of sailing, and you're going through these high seas. You can't just be crazy, because otherwise you'd make a mistake. You'd turn the wheel the wrong way.
Well, you know, when he started his TV news, he'd never been in the news business before. And he had this idea that perhaps news would be well introduced not only with the anchor person, but with a dog. Now, we've got a clip of that just to show the audience what we mean.
Good morning. Hope you're doing okay this morning. Morning, Jim.
There was an FCC requirement to put news on. Instead of putting real news on, Turner put on joke news.
Ronald Reagan hopes to beat.
Well, there's Harry. There's your anchorman. Yeah. How did he ever get to be a newsman when his approach to news was so odd?
Well, he developed. You know, what it's interesting about Ted Turner is he develops. He certainly was not interested in news, and Rees Schonfeld deserves the credit for encouraging him to do 24-hour television. And his approach to it was to have a dog and do all sorts of other things because he thought news was boring. When he discovered that news could be exciting, and he developed a passionate interest in the world. I mean, he is a leading fighter for the environment. He's a leading fighter for peace. He is sponsoring now, with his wealth, means of controlling nuclear power, nuclear bombs. So he's been ahead of his time. So now it's certainly true that he made a fool of news, and in a sense, news made a fool of him. But now he's a changed man. I think he's really passionately interested in what happens to our world. And you know what I like about him? He's not afraid to come out and make a stand and not just simply embrace the conventional wisdom on things like the environment or global warming. I mean, here we have global warming, the most serious crisis facing the world, probably next to nuclear proliferation. It's hard to say. President Bush ignores 300 scientists. And the general, you know, the press sort of goes along with it, and nobody makes a real fuss about this fact. So you get people in Florida who've had four hurricanes in a season voting for this. Serves them right, almost, one feels like saying, if they don't understand the correlation between the two. But Ted Turner's been fighting that cause for years.
Let's go back to the central theme of your book, and that is effectively what makes innovators innovate, how did they do it, so forth and so on. Now, earlier in this show, you talked about the invention that Ted Turner had. His invention was to use the satellite and deliver through the satellite news or whatever he had, because he didn't start with news, because he had an independent station. It went up the satellite, and it came down to these new cable television stations, and that earns him a place in your book. But, I mean, that wasn't really his idea. As you said earlier, that was really the people who invented HBO. Because you remember back in the early days of television, there wasn't any HBO.
That's right.
There wasn't any television without advertisements. And HBO, with Gerald Levin and Chuck Dolan, who now owns Cablevision, put together HBO. Shouldn't they be in the book instead of Ted Turner? It was their great idea. And this is a book not about global warming, which is nice to talk about Ted Turner and enhances his reputation, I agree with you. But this book is about the great innovators. Shouldn't Chuck Dolan and Jerry Levin been in there and not Ted Turner?
Well,
what's so great about Ted Turner's invention?
What's great about, you know, one of the characteristics of innovators is they very often are not first, but they take an idea or two ideas and put them together to create an unbeatable new combination. Now, HBO, yes, the use of the satellite was clever, but what were they putting on it? Standard fare, movies. What was Ted Turner putting on the satellite? Something completely new. Television news for 24 hours. A concept that was so revolutionary that all the networks had never thought of doing it and regarded it as crazy. That was the innovation with him. The technical means, you could credit RCA for the satellite, if you like. But it's not the technical means that are important, it's the use that's made of them. And throughout my book, They Made America, I give instance after instance of somebody who comes along second. Take the steamboat. Robert Fulton is the second. Doesn't have Henry Ford. He's way down the line in terms of creators of the automobile. He's not even the first in Detroit. But he puts together something, the technical means of production, with a vision, a concept. Ford's concept was a car for the people, the Model T. Democratization, you mentioned. Turner's concept was news as it happened, when you wanted it, etc. And so, you know, with the Gulf War, he led everybody, and Tom Brokaw was good enough on NBC to say, We've been beaten. Ted Turner said that. That's the innovation. So Chuck Dolan and Derry Levin were smart businessmen, but not in the class of innovators by any means of Ted Turner.
Let's look at what Ted Turner has wrought. You referred to it a little bit earlier. Can't we blame him for Scream television? Recently, Steve Brill, who founded Court TV, talked about bringing up a reporter from the South and making her the anchor, chief anchor person for Court TV. He's since left Court TV, but she's a big star now. And she's a screamer. And Steve Brill recently was quoted as saying, "I owe a debt to society for bringing her on. I'm so sick of Scream TV." Don't we really have to blame Ted Turner for Scream TV effectively? Because he's the one that created cable news, and that's
it's
become.
Oh, no. That is a total misreading of the situation. You have it completely wrong there. I mean, what's happened to CNN since Ted left is more screams and more giggles, less news, less video, and that's a tragedy. And Fox News has come up with a better produced show, more rigorous production values, and more aggressiveness in getting the news, and that's the secret. That's the tragedy. Whereas Ted Turner, think of Ted Turner of the time a nuclear missile went astray in the United States, and they had on the spot of the military trying to hide this. Think of Ted Turner and the Gulf War. Think of CNN and Christian Amanpour. That's Ted Turner's legacy.
Okay, but what I'm trying to get at, Harry, is that's his legacy, but hasn't his legacy been eroded by events, so that if we're trying to talk about great innovators, and I, at the top of the show, said he was a great innovator, but when you look at him in the light of history, that is, say, over the last 10 years, isn't his achievement being eroded by what cable television news has become? Well, CNN news doesn't have the same production values, isn't as exciting as Fox News, and Fox News doesn't try to do what CNN used to do. And so I'm just wondering whether this achievement is as great as you think it is.
Well, you know, the achievement's solid enough. If there's been a misuse of what he produced and accomplished, I would have to concede you're right. But however, you could make the same argument. You could say, look at the misuse of the Wright brothers' invention of the aeroplane, which was then used to bomb Britain to smithereens by Adolf Hitler. I mean, that the vehicle must be distinguished from the content.
Well, Harry, let's go back to the theme that we have here as to what's driving the persona of Ted Turner.
Right.
We talked a little bit about the nutty things he's done, and you talked a little bit about his general persona. But Ted Turner, I don't know if the public generally realizes, has been on lithium.
Yes.
For a long time. Now, lithium's a very powerful drug.
It's not a drug.
Okay, well, let me put it out before you tell me what I'm saying wrong. But it's a very powerful something that is used for people who have severe psychological problems. Isn't that true?
Well, it's for bipolar disorder, and lithium is a salt, not a drug. It's not an addictive drug, and it treats a chemical imbalance in the brain. And the people who've had bipolar disorder include Abraham Lincoln, Handler,
wait.
Charles Dickens, people who suffer.
Abraham Lincoln was bipolar?
Yes, many. I have a medical report in my pocket of the many people who've been suspected of being bipolar and the sense of being manic depressive, having periods of tremendous rushing energy and periods of depression. This is very, very common thing. Now, Ted Turner has it in an extreme degree, I think, at least from what I read. And not until 1980 or so did he get onto lithium, which is a salt which addresses the imbalance. And the trouble with lithium is if you take it when you take alcohol as well, then you're in danger of actually behaving a little bit in the way you were describing earlier on. And I think that lithium's helped Ted Turner enormously. There's probably no doubt he suffers from his father had a similar bipolarity in his psychology. Well, I'm not a psychologist or a medical man.
Well,
I'm telling you.
No, but it's a little unusual. Ted Turner speaking of his father, kept a pistol in his desk.
Yeah, the .38. Yeah.
Why did he do that?
Well, his father shot himself.
What's that got to do with?
Well, I think it could be two ways you could read it. One, he kept this sort of thing, well, if I get in really terrible depression, I could do the same. And in reminder, his father gave him a hard time, and he always wanted to live up to his father's ambitions for himself. And the pistol was a kind of reminder also of this: your father died hoping you would do something great. This pistol's there to remind you, not for you to kill yourself. And I don't think, you know, Ted's sexuality and his promiscuity and all that are all part of this this syndrome, I think. Don't take away, I don't think, from his accomplishments. And you think of some of the great Hemingway and Virginia Woolf are two others. Yeah.
Let's take, talking about his greatest accomplishment, let's put a clip on now that talks about Baghdad and the internationalization and democratization of news.
We're going back over to the window now.
CNN was the democratization of information. For the first time in the history of the world, every world leader and everybody in the world had access to the same information at the same time.
Would you say this is his greatest achievement, whereby having satellite news, everybody saw it at the same time, and there was a democratization of news, as he says?
I think that is it. You've summed it up perfectly. Democratization of news. What happened, what I argue in my book, is basically that many of the great innovators are democratizers, making available to the masses what had previously been available only to the rich. And that is a very significant feature of American innovation and a very significant feature of Ted Turner's achievement. I'll give you another example. Peter Giannini in California had the idea, a revolutionary idea. He was regarded as nuts. What was the idea? That everybody should be able to borrow from a bank if they had good character. Until he came along, you could only borrow from a bank if you didn't need the money, if you were rich. So Giannini had the idea of giving it, the collateral of James Goodale is of sterling character, his wife's going to have a baby, we'll lend him a loan to get a decent place to live, knowing that he will work hard to get it. On that concept, the democratization of banking and money, Giannini built the largest bank in the world, the Bank of America. Today, Ted Turner has similarly made available to everyone. I mean, the CIA and President Bush learned about what was happening in Iraq thanks to CNN.
And also, world leaders talk to each other on CNN. If you want to reach a world leader in a way that a phone conversation is not appropriate, you talk to him or her and the public at the same time, and the leader at the other end of the conversation, so to speak, as he or she watches CNN, is able to respond. I mean, that's something absolutely new.
That's amazing. And think of the impact of Begin meeting Sadat in Egypt and the two-way flow of images, or even today the Ukraine, or what's going on in Iraq. So it's all pretty, you know, powerful stuff, really.
There are some that think that the fall of communism can be attributed to the media, BBC probably as much as anything else, but also the fact that the images were being pirated and spread around the Soviet Union, and those images showed how the West lived.
This is true. You know, I'll tell you what's an indication of how important CNN is: the trouble that people like the Iranian mullahs go to stop those images percolating. The trouble that Arafat went to stop this image of the Palestinians dancing with joy in the streets for 9/11, which we found so painful, the enormous.
We would have never seen that as it took place without Ted Turner.
Exactly right.
No. We could have seen a picture, still picture of the dancing. We could have read about it. That image would not be competitive with Ted Turner.
And that's why they go. And that's a measure of the significance. If somebody goes to enormous attempts to censor or suppress you, you must be doing something right. That's, as a journalist, I say that, you know?
Well, Harry, we're getting close to the end here. I want to push you a little bit on summing up your theory about Ted Turner. Was Ted Turner a madman or a genius? And perhaps, is everyone in your book a madman or a genius?
Most of the people in my book have very dramatic and spectacular lives. There are quite a number of suicides in the book. The man who gave us radio, the man who gave you the sound that you're using this morning, FM sound for television, was Edwin Armstrong. Jumped to his death in the River House, 52nd Street, New York. George Eastman took a pistol and killed himself, the inventor of modern photography. Quite a number committed suicide. So.
A number committed suicide.
Oh yeah, quite a lot of innovators committed suicide.
So Ted Turner with his
pistol in his door. I hope.
And he's always referring to, "I'm dead," falling on the floor of the Senate. "I'm dead." Well, he was on a concierge table in Los Angeles before he met with Bowie Kuhn and said, "Bowie Kuhn's going to kill me. He's going to kill me."
Well, I those examples of wild behavior. Are many of them, and I hope he's never going to do anything silly like that because he's made an enormous contribution. You use the past tense of the verb. I prefer to say Ted Turner is a genius.
He is a
genius. Not was, but Ted Turner is a genius. Yes, a genius who suffers from certain common eccentricities among geniuses, but Ted Turner is not mad.
Harry, he's a genius, he's eccentric, but not mad. Thank you very much for coming by, Harry Evans.
Thank you. See you then.
And thank you very much for coming by. And come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.